This video is prepared by Avya Classes. Please subscribe the channel, raise your doubt and watch the video for sure success in JEE, AIIMS and NEET. So first we have defined the collision, in which we said that the collision is an isolated event where a strong force acts between two bodies, and because of however this force acts for the very short duration of time, and the energy and momentum of interacting particle changes, like collision of two balls, two billiards ball, or the collision of a bat and the ball. In collision, the particle may or may not come in the real touch. We have already seen that the collision with physical contact is the collision of a bat and a ball, collision between two billiards ball, while collision without physical contact is the head-on collision of alpha particle with gold nucleus. So here we have see that if you see a gold nucleus and alpha particle strikes, then it will not actually hit it, but it will move from a distance d from the nucleus of from the gold nucleus, where we have the maximum potential energy. As we know that when the alpha particle moves, then it will get a retarding force, and because of this retarding force from this gold nucleus, its potential energy starts increasing. At this point p, it will have a maximum potential energy, and afterwards it just recoils in the same direction. So for this for the convenient, I just shown in the different way that these two paths are making an angle theta. However, this the body moves in such a way, it just come here, and then just before a distance d, it will return back. So it's a head-on collision of alpha particle with gold nucleus. Now we have also learned the stages of collision. In the stage of collision, I have drawn the force time graph, and we just divide the whole process of collision into three parts, which is the first before collision, during collision and after collision part. The external force we shown here, and it is a constant throughout the collision, which is a very small. It's a force of gravity, force of friction, and very small, and we may neglect it. So basically during the process of collision, we have a zero external force, so the conservation of momentum takes place. As we know that from the Newton's second law, that dp by dt is equal to f external, and the external force will be equal to zero. So dp is equal to zero and p is equal to constant, so momentum will be conserved in case of collision. Here also, if you see this figure, then before the collision, these two interacting particles have no any force exerting on each other. After the during the process of collision, that is at the time t1, when these two bodies starts touching each other, then you may see that the force they start putting on themselves on the other body. So as the collision progress on, during the collision these two body compress each other, so the kinetic energy changes into the potential energy when these two body compresses, and at a time reaches when we have a maximum compression. Suppose this is the time of maximum compression when these two body compressed, and we have a maximum force, and this is represented by this point, the maximum force. Afterwards these two body starts moving away from each other, and this potential energy again started converted into the kinetic energy. So at the time t2, when these two body move away from each other, then the force will be, the interacting force will be reduced to zero, and after collision these two body moves from v1 to v2. So in this, from this figure, if we can infer two things. First thing is that the interacting force occurs between during the collision. So first thing is that interacting force will be zero before collision and after collision, and during collision the interacting force
will not be equal to 0. It's a very high value for a very short duration. Second thing is that during the collision, as you see that the deformation takes place. Here the deformation takes place, and because of deformation the kinetic energy changes into potential energy. So this process, during this process we may say kinetic energy is converted into potential energy, as the potential energy is associated with the configuration of body. So the configuration of body changes, the potential energy increases, and the kinetic energy is converted into potential energy. Afterwards, when the body are moving away from each other, so if you see, that is during this period of time, the potential energy will again started converted into kinetic energy. So in case of perfectly elastic collision, the whole kinetic energy and the whole potential energy will be converted into kinetic energy, while in case of other kind of collision, some potential energy will be lost in terms of heat and sound and other kind of other forms of energy. So all those things are written here, that that the collision in the before and after interaction force is zero. During collision we have a large interaction force, and this force will be treated as an internal force. We treat external force for very short duration and we treat is equal to zero or very small, so we just make the conservation of momentum in case of collision. So clearly, as the conservation of momentum in case of collision, so in any type of collision the conservation of momentum take place. So how we will utilize this? So basically we write the initial momentum is equal to final momentum, and as the momentum is a vector quantity, so we may write into its component form also, that is in the form of ijk. So it is written here. So if I write the momentum in form of ijk, we just equate the individual components, that is the initial momentum along x-axis is denoted by pix, and initial momentum along final momentum along x-axis is denoted by pfx. So pix is equal to pfx, piy is equal to pfy, and pij is equal to pfj. We have also seen the different cases of calculation of initial momentum, that is when the momentum of each ball is making an angle theta I, that is if you see that the momentum of body one is making an angle theta one with the x-axis, while the other body is making an angle theta two with the x-axis. The first body is making with an angle theta one clockwise, while other is making theta two anti-clockwise. So you can calculate the net momentum after breaking it into individual component, and we get the net initial momentum is in this way, that is PA cos theta 1 plus PB cos theta 2 I plus PB sin theta 2 minus PA sin theta 1 J. We have already learned these all things. We have also seen a second case when the momentum of each ball is given making an angle theta between them, and we just apply momentum being a vector quantity, we just utilize the vector addition formula, and if the theta between the momentum of these two body, then we just get the initial total momentum is equal to PA square plus PB square plus twice PA PB cos theta, where PA is the initial momentum of body 1. Like if a body is mass m1 moving with a velocity u1, body B is having mass m2 and velocity u2, then PA is equal to m1 u1 and PB is equal to m2 u2. So why we are reading all those things? Because sometimes they are utilized too much in solving the problem. You have to calculate the initial total momentum, and then you have to utilize the concept of conservation of momentum. So we have learned these concepts already. We have also learned the energy conservation, concepts of energy conservation in case of collision. We have learned that the total energy is always conserved, but the total mechanical energy may or may not be conserved. The conservation of mechanical energy is observed in case of elastic collision. So basically we have divided collision into three parts. We have learned that the collision is divided into three parts: elastic collision, inelastic collision, perfectly elastic collision. In case of elastic collision, and the velocity at which the body strikes or to the other body, the first body strikes with the other body, is equal to the velocity with which it just gets separated from it. So if I drop a ball from height h, then in case of elastic collision it will again move to a height h. So because the velocity of approach will be equal to velocity of separation, so here because the velocity of approach will be velocity of separation, and coefficient of restitution is defined as the velocity of separation, relative velocity of separation divided by relative velocity of approach. So in case of a perfectly elastic collision, we have coefficient of restitution equal to 1. In case of inelastic collision, if I drop a ball from height h, then it will not move up to height h again. It will move up to height h1, so where h is greater than h1. And from the figure that here, if the body approach or the ball approaches the ground with velocity v and leaves the ground with a velocity v1, then v must be greater than v1. So here we may say that the velocity of separation will be less than the velocity of approach, and e will be less than equal to 1. However, e will be greater than 0. In case of perfectly inelastic collision, the both body after collisions move simultaneously as a single unit, and because of this the coefficient of restitution will be equal to 0. We have also learned the types of collision based on the conservation of kinetic energy, where in case of perfectly elastic collision, the kinetic energy final will be kinetic energy initial, and while in case of inelastic collision, the final kinetic energy will be less than the initial kinetic energy, because some initial kinetic energy is converted into internal energy of the product, such as heat, elastic and excitation. While in case of perfectly inelastic collision, there is a maximum loss of kinetic energy because the body stick and move together with each other. Regarding coefficient of restitution, in case of perfectly elastic it is equal to 1, for perfectly inelastic it is equal to 0, for inelastic collision it is between 0 to 1. And the example is that collision between atomic particle comes under the perfectly elastic, the maximum number of collision it comes under the inelastic collision, like collision between two billiard balls, collision between two automobiles, while in case of perfectly inelastic, when a bullet is fired to a block of wood, then when it stick into it, embedded into it and moves simultaneously with the block, then this is the example of perfectly inelastic collision. Type collision is based on the direction of colliding body, and in this case the first is head-on or one-dimensional collision. We have already learned that if the motion of colliding particle before and after the collision is along the same line, before and after the collision is along the same line, then the collision is said to be head-on or one-dimensional collision. And we have learned that in this case impact parameter B will be 0. So this is the figure for head-on collision, and if you see that here, after and before the collision, the body is moving in the same direction and the impact parameter is 0. Again, we have learned that on the basis of direction of collision, the second category is oblique collision. So if two particles in the collision are such that the direction of motion after collision is not along the same line of or the initial line of motion, then collision is called as oblique. Like if you see in this figure, then M1 and M2 are undergo through the collision, and the direction of motion of M1 is not along the initial line of motion. So here if you see that the impact parameter B is not equal to 0. We have already learned that the impact parameter B lies between 0 to R1 plus R2. So the maximum value of impact parameter can be R1 plus R2, where R1 and R2 is the radii of colliding body. we have also learned the concept of coefficient of restitution, and it is the ratio of relative velocity of separation divided by relative velocity of approach, and it is denoted by E. So E is equal to V2 minus V1 divided by E1 minus U2. So if you see this figure, if the two bodies M1 and M2 are moving such that the M1 is moving with a velocity U1 and M2 is moving with a velocity U2, and after collision, this is figure for before collision, and after collision M1 is moving with the velocity V1 and M2 with the velocity V2, then if you see that the velocity of separation will be V2 minus V1, velocity of separation will be V2 minus V1, while velocity of approach will be U1 minus U2, because in order to approach, U1 must be greater than U2, and for the separation, V2 must be greater than V1. So E is equal to V2 minus V1 divided by U1 minus U2, and from there we get an important relation, and it is equal to V2 minus V1 is equal to E into U1 minus U2. So this is the concept of coefficient of restitution. For the perfectly elastic collision, coefficient of restitution will be equal to 1, and in this case velocity of separation will be equal to velocity of approach, while for the perfectly inelastic collision, as the two body moves as a single unit, these two body stick and then move, so we may say that coefficient of restitution is equal to 0, and in this case V2 is equal to V1, that is these two body moves together. So, and for the inelastic collision, which lies between the perfectly elastic and perfectly inelastic collision, the coefficient of restitution lies between 0 and 1, and so this is the concept of coefficient of restitution. We have already learned it, and we may say that the E is the degree of elasticity of collision, and it is a dimensionless